Therapy Chat Podcast, episode 170.
This is the Therapy Chat Podcast with Laura Reagan, LCSW-C. The information shared in this podcast is not a substitute for seeking help from a licensed mental health professional. And now, here's your host, Laura Reagan, LCSW-C.
Today's episode is sponsored by Therapy Notes. Between writing notes, filing insurance claims, and scheduling with clients, it can be hard to stay organized. That's why I recommend Therapy Notes. Their easy-to-use platform lets you manage your practice securely and efficiently. Visit therapynotes.com to get 2 free months of Therapy Notes today. Just use the promo code THERAPYCHAT when you sign up for a free trial at therapynotes.com. Hi, welcome back to Therapy Chat. Today's conversation is so interesting. I was talking with my guest about intuition and neuroscience and so many things. My guest today is one of the most interesting people I have ever spoken with because she's doing so many different things that would seem to be unrelated. And I can't wait to share this fascinating interview with you. So before we start, let me just tell you a bit more about the person you're going to be hearing from. Terry Marks-Tarlow, Ph.D., is a clinical psychologist and independent researcher in private practice in Santa Monica, California. She's adjunct faculty at Pacifica Graduate Institute in Santa Barbara, core faculty at the Insight Center, Los Angeles, research associate of the Institute for Fractal Research, Kassel, Germany, and visiting professor, Italian Università Niccolò Cusano, London. She trains internationally and nationally on clinical intuition as a bottom-up holistic faculty by which unconscious body-based knowledge bubbles up to conscious response. Are you curious yet? She's fascinated by the varieties of ordinary and extraordinary knowing, which address the entire context of this person in this moment of this relationship. Dr. Marks-Tarlow has authored several books, including Clinical Intuition and Psychotherapy and Truly Mindful Coloring. She illustrates all of her books herself, curates a yearly arts exhibition of psychotherapist art called Mirrors of the Mind, I'm curious about that, and immerses herself in the arts through dance, yoga, and writing opera librettos, one of which premiered at Lincoln Center in New York City in 2018. I mean, come on. I am very fortunate to be bringing you what I found to be, and I think you will also find, to be a fascinating interview with Dr. Terry Marks-Tarlow. So let's just dive right in. Therapy Chat Podcast wouldn't exist without the support of its listeners. If you'd like to become a member, please go to patreon.com/therapychat. By making a $1 per month donation, you can help Therapy Chat keep going over the long haul. Thank you for your support. Hi, welcome back to Therapy Chat. Today, I am very happy to be talking with someone who I know is going to be a fascinating guest. My guest today is Dr. Terry Marks-Tarlow. Terry, thanks so much for being on Therapy Chat today.
And thank you so much, Laura, for inviting me. It's a pleasure to be here.
Yeah, you're welcome. I'm really curious about your work. I found out about you through your book, Clinical Intuition and Psychotherapy, The Neurobiology of Embodied Response. I was like, oh, yeah, I want to learn all about that. And I know you have a workbook as well with that. So, but let's just start off by, if you will, you telling our audience a bit about yourself and your work.
Absolutely. So I am a clinical psychologist. I've been in practice in Santa Monica, California since 1985. And I am really interested in creativity and intuition, as you mentioned, and neurobiology. And I also really try to immerse myself in the things that interest me. So I illustrate all my books and I take creative journeys to far off places that I don't belong. I've written a libretto. I've written two librettos for an opera that opened in Lincoln Center in New York City recently.
Cool.
Yeah, I know. Really exciting.
Gosh.
So I'm happy to talk about anything that you want to.
Oh my gosh. Yes, that's fascinating. And I didn't catch that you illustrate your own books. I think that is so amazing because I think I'm personally very interested in the, I guess you could say, how intuition, I guess sort of like connecting the science and the creativity and sort of spiritual aspects of intuition, you know, because people tend to be like either scientifically minded or creative and open to existential stuff and different types of perception. So this seems to be a perfect marrying of both.
You know, you're catching right away something that's very, very important to me. It's true. People are either very left brain about these topics or very right brain. And one place that I try to meet them in the middle, because I really do try to use both sides, the artistic, the scientific. And another one of my interests that I have also written extensively on is nonlinear science, and especially fractal geometry. And I think that that form of science actually itself marries the art with the science of these topics, which that's one of the most fascinating topics to me, is how those things come together. So
I knew you were going to be interesting to talk to, but you are already blowing my mind.
Well, thank you. Thank you. Yeah. Another book called Psyche's Veil, which I also illustrated. And I think the reason I came to illustrate my own books is because a long time ago, I was trying to decide between being an artist and being a therapist. Or being a psychologist. And I went to Rhode Island School of Design for a summer and drew over the summer. And at the end of it, decided I didn't have enough talent and it was too lonely and I'd never be able to support myself if I became an artist. So I became I didn't think I had enough talent. And so I became a psychologist and only came back to art because I started delving in these topics, these nonlinear topics that there didn't exist visuals for. And so when I started to think about drawing as communication and as visual communication, then suddenly I was back in the art sphere and marrying these two things without worrying about not having talent.
So cool. And, you know, I guess this is my own personal bias, but my dad is like this very logical type of person who just really sees things like people would typically say an engineer does, just very black and white, very logical. And my mom's an artist and she's always been into like crystals and, you know, meditation. And when I was a kid, I was like, oh my gosh, mom, please. But now I can be very logical, but I also am, my soul is fed by, you know, getting those intuitive moments and those moments of, you know, a deeper awareness. I can't separate the two ways of thinking. It's both for me.
Right. It's true. When you hang out at the edges of those things, you really can't pull them apart. And it's also true that there is a spiritual feeling and spiritual edge to how these places come together. I totally agree with that, especially when with the intuition. And I'm getting braver about how I hold intuition and how I present it. In that book, by focusing on the neurobiology, it's a very grounded approach. It's, you know, grounding it in the body, in the senses, in the brain, in unconscious processes of picking up things below the level of awareness and, you know, different structures like the amygdala that are subcortical and pick up things. without us even knowing it, so that our bodies respond and our minds might not even know where it's coming from. But I'm also getting bolder about kind of the edges of intuition that, and not just the local kind where you're sitting in the room with someone and you're using all these cues by sight and, you know, by feel and other sensory information, but the non-local kind where a good example is a patient brought in my childhood dream. And a very different dream than she's ever had. And it served the purpose of breaking an impasse between us and just completely blew me away. And that kind of unconscious to unconscious communication is part of intuition that is, it's just as ordinary, but it's also really extraordinary in so many ways.
Absolutely. And I think, you know, one of the barriers to clinicians using tapping into our intuition and using it in our work with clients is that not knowing how to explain it.
Yes. And because people have called it airy-fairy or because people have been sexist about associating it with feminine intuition and this sort of thing, then we almost hide and don't admit or don't want to admit how much we all use it. But I really believe that every effective therapist is tapping into intuition on a minute-to-minute basis. That's really my stance, is that what we use to bridge that gap between theory and practice is intuition, and that we, no matter what our orientation, that we're all doing it. And not only that, I'll go so far as to say that as we help people that we're working with come to healthier places, that we're teaching them to tap into their own intuition, because I do believe it's the most complex faculty that we have.
Can you say more about that? Like how you see intuition, its role in our lives and in our work as therapists and for any individual?
Sure. They're basically two different faculties, I'll say, two different ways of learning and having memory. And one is explicit learning and memory, and that's all very conscious. It's very top down. It starts in the head. It's like having an idea and then actualizing it in the body. And then there are implicit processes, and that's the bottom-up stuff. And that starts with the senses, with emotion, with the deep unconscious, and knowledge bubbles up from the body into the mind through the implicit realm. And we all start life out by tapping into the implicit, not through the explicit. So the first 2 years of life, babies are learning, you know, the whole foundation for the rest of their life, our lives is set in the first 2 years through the implicit channel. So it's extremely, and the implicit, because it's nonlinear, it's primarily nonverbal, it takes in, it's the more through the right brain than the left brain. And the left brain, which does the explicit stuff, operates in a vacuum. It doesn't really tap into what's going on in the body except through the right brain, which is the foundation for all of us. And whereas the right brain goes deep into the viscera, goes into the body, and the body's open to the environment. So in that sense, it's really only through our intuition that we have an open portal to the rest of the universe. And if the universe itself is all interconnected, which I believe it is, from a nonlinear perspective, which is a holistic perspective, you can't break the holes down into parts. It all fits together without really clean boundaries between. So that faculty, the implicit processes and intuition, is the only one that has that level of openness. It's the only one that takes the full context into account, and it doesn't break things down, and it doesn't operate on a line. It operates in a, in a more holistic way, and integrating all of the senses holistically as well. So it's sort of like the reason that I think it's not just clinicians. So it is our most holistic faculty. It operates much quicker and automatically than the analytic side. And it is the most complex because it's able to process the full context. And I think psychotherapy is one of the most complex endeavors we can do, because it's not just solving a problem. It's dealing with a person who's got an entire history, with developmental history that comes into play in every moment. And the people are often talking about the whole rest of their lives. Plus, it's how those dynamics play out in the room between the therapist and the person. And so it's incredibly complex. And the analytic side just can't capture that complexity the way that intuition can. And then for patients, we need intuition, especially in this day and age where there is complete information overload and where we can't really look to generations that preceded us to guide us in the same way that maybe hundreds of years ago, when expectations were in place and people copied the generation before, etc., rules and that kind of guidelines and external information was a lot more effective than today, when we have to sort through so much complexity. So unless we're moving from the inside out, it's not very effective. Is that too long?
No, but the last thing you said, when you said, unless we're moving from the inside out, I wonder if you could just expand on that a little.
Sure. I tend to think of intuition as a way of moving from the inside out, as opposed to the more rational, which is often from the outside in. If somebody tells us what to do, we're moving from the outside in. When we have a felt sense of how we're feeling, what decision we want to make, that's moving from the inside out, and as does creativity, and as does the imagination. And so all of that comes into play with intuition, and I think is the most solid way for anybody to move. And that doesn't mean moving from the inside out as in blocking out information, but it does mean processing information and then coming to where one stands with it from the integrity of our full selves. And that can only be done through intuition.
Thank you for going into that a little more there about that last part.
I even have a developmental model of how that works, which is in the book that you have, the Clinical Intuition in Psychotherapy book. And I can try to explain it if you're interested. It's a little bit complicated, but essentially the hippocampus, which is the memory center of our brains, is also in rats and other mammals. That's, by the way, the approach that I take in clinical intuition in psychotherapy, and more broadly, is to connect our human intuition with animal intuition, because it turns out that our emotional and motivational circuitry is basically the same. It's pretty much identical. So the stuff I was talking about that happens in the first 2 years of life not only happens in humans, but it happens in all mammals. that through parenting and attuned parenting and secure attachment, et cetera, animals learn to navigate in the environment and start out being dependent on caretakers in order to come into themselves. And so the hippocampus in other mammals is the physical, is used for physical navigation through the environment, like in rats. And there is a guy named Busaki who is a nonlinear researcher who studies physical navigation in rats. And he's got this two-part theory about how rats get oriented in the environment. And the first one is from the inside out, a rat needs to be able to explore its environment thoroughly. It needs to be able to move through the environment and approach any point from every other point by feel. And once it does that, then an internal map develops and it can use information. It sort of coordinates all the senses and coordinates the senses with the motor capacities. And then once that's been done and an internal map has been formed, the rat can then use information from the outside in. So it can look around and see a water dish or something like that and have a sense of where that is in the environment. So when I was talking about inside out and outside in humans, the hippocampus not only is used for physical navigation, but it turns out we use it to navigate through social space also. And that's really what memory does. It helps us navigate through social space. It's not just memorizing facts. It's really how do we move in the world? And so we have to have that same two-step process where we get oriented by having all of our senses and our body come into alignment so that it's all working together and that we can have maps from the inside of the outside. And then we're moving, you know, by from the inside out through intuition by feel.
That's fascinating. Thank you for explaining that. And I mean,
you're welcome.
I'm always wanting to consume more about the felt sense and what's really happening there, because it's a nonverbal process. It's so hard to explain it.
It is hard to explain it. And yet the nonverbal is pretty much everything. You know, it's, I guess for in general, it's the difference when somebody has a dilemma and their immediate reaction is to go to 20 different people and ask for advice. And everybody gives a different answer, and they're left more confused than ever.
Mm-hmm.
Then we can, you know, pretty easily tell that they're trying to operate from the outside in, and it's not working very well. Or in therapy, if our patients come to us and they're just looking for signs from us about what they think we think that they should do. They're trying to use us, you know, to operate from the outside in, when really what they need is the support and the foundation to sit for a moment with all of it and find what's right for them from inside. And so I guess that model does provide a bit of structure to this topic of intuition, which so often is so hard to get our heads around and be able to articulate.
Yes. Yes. I really want to ask you, I hope this is going to fit. When you talked about the first 2 years of life being the foundation for everything about the way we are in the world, basically, right? I'm really curious because my work is mainly working with people who have complex trauma and, you know, developmental trauma. So, you know, I feel and believe that children use their intuition. It's how they sense, you know, themselves in the world and how they know what's going on. but that we adults through, you know, traditional parenting tend to kind of make them lose their connection with that.
Absolutely. I agree with you 100% that so many parents are under the illusion that because a baby can't talk, that they don't understand what's going on in the environment.
Right.
And then infants and young children are exposed to things that they're also taught they're not supposed to be paying attention to. So we adults wind up teaching children how to go unconscious when those are the messages that we're not supposed to pay attention to the awful thing that is being heard in the bedroom or something like that. And we do. We teach children how to dissociate and how to disconnect that way. Whereas if you come into parenting with the assumption that babies understand everything emotionally, and that understanding everything emotionally is actually more sophisticated than understanding it cognitively.
Yes.
Then we can honor the sensitivity and exquisite sensitivity of babies and children and protect them from this problem of teaching them how to be unconscious and then having to go into therapy in order to try to reconnect with what is naturally connected to begin with.
Yeah, exactly. Because, you know, when thinking about what you said, children understand, they know what's going on. They see and understand what's happening. And we give them the message, pretend you don't know this. And then they do that to protect us. They're the child.
That's right. You know? Right. Because they need to serve our needs. And when our needs include them not paying attention to what we don't want to deal with, then we're really creating a problem. As you were talking then, I was just thinking about the practice in Bali with babies. Apparently, a baby is not put down, is never touches the ground for the first 6 months because babies are considered closer to heaven and they're honored that way and they're honored by being held and held off the ground. So to me, that's a sort of a spiritual acknowledgement of in some ways how much closer to this interconnection between everything than many of us are, especially when we lose that sensibility. If we get too in our heads, we lose the connection between our bodies and the rest of the universe.
Yeah. So I was wondering, one of the things that came up for me when you said that about the first 2 years of life is what happens to a person's intuition if they are made to be dissociative in that time, like maybe because whatever needs they have, the parent reacts to and they, you know, the child shuts down because of that.
Mm-hmm. Well, and I think that it sounds like a lot of the people that you're working with in your practice may be people who have had that happen. There's a lot of evidence. So by the way, what we're really talking about here is interpersonal neurobiology.
Yeah.
Which is a relatively new field. And my mentor, one of my mentors, Alan Shore, has taken attachment theory. So this idea about the first 2 years of life is straight attachment theory. And he's really translated attachment theory into what's going on in the brain and nervous system in the process of those first 2 years of life developmentally and which really grounds the whole thing. And it turns out that we often mistake trauma as being a sort of a one-time event. Someone gets in a car accident or somebody goes to goes to war and is exposed to really scary stuff. But it turns out that there is a really much subtler form of trauma that does develop in the first 2 years of life. That's relational trauma, which happens if the caregiver, usually the mother, is not well attuned to the needs, to the emotional needs of the baby. And then out of that rupture, there's often a shutdown, and the dissociation occurs, which sets that baby up for a predisposition to be traumatized later in life and a predisposition to other psychiatric problems. And there's really, as a developmental theory, regulation theory, which is attachment theory plus the brain and nervous system, is the most successful and predictive of all the developmental theories. And for that reason, it is so important if a patient or a client comes in who's traumatized, it's really important to understand whether that is a one-time kind of trauma that happened later in life, or whether there's been this kind of very early trauma that isn't, it's in the body, it's in implicit processes, but it is not, if it starts before age two, it may not, there may be no autobiographical memory at all. And yet the body registers it at this implicit level.
Yeah, so true. And I hope all the therapists who are listening will consider that when working with someone and saying, this person presents as if they've experienced trauma, but they don't have a trauma history, you know, because oftentimes they don't know of a trauma history, but
that's right.
They're showing you that there is one.
That's right. And sometimes it's even totally paradoxical, in that one of the major forms of insecure attachment, which is avoidant and dismissive attachment, if you ask that person what their childhood was like, they will often say it was great.
Had a perfect family.
They had a perfect family. And so that way of not being able to tap into what was their own emotions, and or having vivid memories about childhood itself is a form of trauma.
Yes. Thanks for saying that. And that's, you know, I think that's one of the big dilemmas of working with people who have that experience, is that you don't want to deny the way they report that it was. And they're also giving you information that it means that it likely, you know, their needs weren't met, and they don't know how to articulate that because they are disconnected from it.
Their needs weren't met, and they learned how to self-regulate, and it, meaning they learned how to take care of their own needs themselves, either by rocking, sucking their thumb, whatever.
Twirling their hair. Blanket.
Their hair.
Yeah.
Right. And addictions fall into this category many times, that is a form of self-soothing and self-regulating, where of taking care of themselves alone, as opposed to towards relationship as the way of soothing upset and calming the nervous system.
This is so interesting. So my next question for you in this realm is, how can anyone, and people ask me about this often, because like you're talking about, I do work with people in trying to connect with their own intuition and to trust their inner knowing. And people will say, how do I know the difference between my inner knowing or my intuition and like a trauma response, like a fight or flight, or, you know, a fear response that's saying this is a dangerous situation when, you know, it doesn't seem dangerous. And it's very confusing. And I think for therapists too, that can be really confusing.
Mm-hmm. That is true. When people have been highly traumatized, then their amygdala, which is the structure in the brain that picks up safety or danger, is hyper vigilant. And when that happens, there can be a sort of a false reading about danger. So depending on what we're talking about having intuition about, the safest way to answer your question is to say that intuition is going to operate most fully in all of us when we feel safe. And because when we feel safe, then, and in, as I said, I like to connect human intuition with animal intuition. And in doing that, there are two different circuits that I think it taps into. One is the seeking circuit, and that's the sort of the granddaddy of them all for positive experiences. It's the circuit that makes us want to go into the world and get our needs met. And then the second one is the play circuit. And all mammals play and all children need to play, and they only play when they're safe. And I think that in its most kind of primitive form, that intuition is in a sense a form of play. It's playing with the world and playing with ideas, playing with imagination, and playing with possible futures. And we really do need to be safe in order to play. A traumatized child does not play, and a traumatized animal does not play. So already what you're talking about of having the intuition that there's danger in the room that's not a safe room. And yet that is a form of intuition, and it is an important one. It just uses different circuits in a sense. And I think, how do you tell the difference? Well, if you know that you have been traumatized, and you know that you have that hypersensitivity, then I think you have to trust that you can't trust it automatically, that you have to actually gather more feedback because it won't necessarily be trustworthy.
Yeah, so that makes sense to me. And so if, like, for example, let's say someone is talking about their partner and they've been trying to be more vulnerable, asking for what they need from their partner, and they say, I know he's not going to meet my need. It's not possible. He can't. I just know this deep in my soul.
That's a great example. I mean, really, Laura, the way that when someone says that to me, I actually say that is a traumatized statement, because in a healthy relationship, we shouldn't even try to know what someone is going to do, how they're going to respond. Predicting the future is not the best use for intuition, and I'm not a big fan of it, because chaos theory tells us that the future is fundamentally unpredictable, and no matter how well we know or can model the present. So that kind of intuition, not only am I skeptical about, but I don't think it's healthy, because when partners do that with each other, when they're actually scripting out what the other one's going to say, it's a non-relational response. And it's a traumatized response, because the way I view trauma is that it's the past is determining the present and the future.
Yes.
And if the future isn't open, then you're in trauma mode. Now, that said, so I will say to people, that's a traumatic response, and unless you can open it up, to find out what's going to happen, then there's no chance that your partner will meet your needs. There's no chance at all. However, that said, if the person is saying that because, over and over they've tried and they can't, and they just absolutely can't get their needs met and have really truly been open in expressing themselves and letting their partners express themselves, then they probably need to leave the relationship. You know, then something has been broken inside and they realize that they cannot trust that partner and need to leave. So there could, you know, that could be an intuitive awareness, but it's also a highly traumatized and defensive response.
That answer is just right for me because, yes, obviously, if they are in an unsafe relationship and they, you know, they see that it's not changing, even though they feel like they're giving every effort and the other person isn't putting in any effort, that's different information. But it still doesn't mean that you can predict the future, but it's more of a your intuition is telling you this is not working. This is not healthy.
But it's so common for couples to do that to one another, you know, to say, I know how he's going to respond, so I'm not even going to say it.
Right. I can't ask him that because he can't possibly do it. He's just not capable.
Yeah. And that is basically a defensive mode where we're not even giving a chance for anything to be different.
Yeah, it's kind of saying there are not unlimited possibilities. There's only one possibility.
And I know what it is and I'm going to preempt it.
Yeah.
And I'm going to let the guy have a chance.
Yeah, which is an attempt to keep yourself safe. But if you can see that it's a trauma response and it's not actually what your intuition is telling you deep inside your soul. It's more like, because it, you know, I think your soul would probably say, well, what if this time could be different?
Mm-hmm.
Right?
Right. And your soul might say, but I'm still in this relationship and I'm probably here for a reason.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Yeah. So, but that distinction that you're wanting to make between a traumatized response and intuition is so important. It's so important. And it's actually for us therapists as well, really important because we have to make that distinction when we respond to the people we're working with as well.
That's so true. And that's exactly what I was thinking, because if the therapist is trying to stay connected to their intuition, but their sense about their client and what the client's presenting in that moment is fear-based versus grounded, you know, they aren't going to make the same clinical decisions, I would think.
That's right. And if the therapist is tapping into their own faculty in a fear-based or traumatized way, then the same is true. And which is why I think when we work in a fully relational way, which I really aspire to do, especially when it comes to these kinds of things about relationships, like when a person comes in and they want feedback about whether their partner is abusive, for example, and the kinds of things they're talking about may be fairly subtle, like, you know, scowling or saying that's ridiculous, or, you know, things that are dismissive, but some people might say it's abusive and other people might not, then our own history, our own developmental history and our own sense of how we feel about relationships and our own tolerance with our partners and all of that's going to come into play in something that appears to be an objective question, but there are no truly objective questions. And
yeah,
my way of dealing with that is I tend to cop to my biases. I tend to really want to both say to people when I'm shooting from the hip and drawing on intuition and I don't know why, I will tell them that, but also the kinds of relationship questions that we're talking about, I will tell them what my bias is about relationship. And I tend to be for them. I tend to, you know, be for helping people understand and be more empathic towards where their partners are and in attempts to work it out. rather than, you know, very quick to say, okay, leave the relationship kind of thing. But I do feel that it's my ethical responsibility really to share those biases from the start.
Yeah. I think, you know, if it's really a minefield potentially to respond to that question, even, you know, without knowing of your own biases and being upfront with them, with yourself and to the client.
Right. Yeah. I bring that one up because it just happened a week ago. And so it's very fresh in my mind. person coming in and really wanting feedback about whether her husband's abusive or not. And it being very, very, you know, not ambiguous. Like if she were being hit or, you know, something like that, it's obvious what the answer is. But especially when people can't see their role in provoking or in not knowing how to step out of an escalation, then, you know, then it gets even more from a nonlinear point of view. There are always two people in a relationship, and both people really create it and co-create it. And it's very, very important to understand that co-creation role in coming to our intuition about what we need to grow. And sometimes we do need to leave to grow. And sometimes we need to stay engaged, but learn how to set boundaries or disconnect in other ways, which if we can't do that, if we're codependent, that also blocks intuition.
So like energetic boundaries.
Yes, energetic boundaries. Exactly. Exactly.
That's interesting what you said, because, you know, I'm very much, I would never encourage someone to stay in a relationship that was abusive. And, you know, basically I want my clients to feel empowered to make their own decisions about everything in their lives. But, you know, we have a role as sort of helping them explore. And even in that way, we can take it in a certain direction if we're not aware of our own biases.
And even when we are aware of our own biases, we often take it in a direction, you know, but at least it's an informed direction.
Yes, exactly. Yes, that's so true. I think, too, the question about abusiveness, when someone has a trauma history, and particularly related to unmet attachment needs, which we really don't often identify as having a trauma history, we can experience the current relationship and certain things that take us back to feeling ignored or abandoned, rejected.
Mm-hmm. And that's exactly, your intuition is right on. That's exactly what was going on in this, with this person who brought that question to me, is that she had cut her father out of her life after years and years and years of his just not showing up and also being cruel at times. She had finally cut the link and had felt good about that. And then about 4 months later, suddenly this anger is coming up towards her husband. And it's all those unfinished issues, because when we physically cut people off or when we go to a different geographic place in order to try to resolve an issue, it doesn't actually get resolved in our heads unless we do the inner work as well. So this is the opportunity for her to do that inner work and then see how she feels about her husband.
Yeah, so true. And that's definitely a little different from the typical paradigm of, you deserve better than that, just leave. If someone doesn't treat you right, you don't have to put up with it, you know. And
sure,
you don't, but at the same time, if you're not,
at the same time, there's a reason that the divorce rate is, you know, more than 50%. That's not because all the people are terrible in the world. It's because we don't know how to honor differences in the other and take our partner as our teacher and take the struggles that come up in marriage as a spiritual mandate to grow. We don't know how to do that. We project it out.
Yeah, conflict resolution is not our strong suit in this country. Conflict is a strong suit, but not the resolution.
That's right. It's so true. My brother was recently nominated for a Nobel Peace Prize. His organization that he started, which is the world's largest peace organization. So I was just thinking, as you said that maybe that sort of rubbed off on me that, you know, that this, I just really have a strong leaning towards conflict resolution, towards finding the harmony between and not demonizing the other person.
Yeah, that you are full of surprises. Your brother is nominated for a Nobel Peace Prize, you casually mention. Goodness.
Yeah.
Well, I feel the same way as you, that the only way to live is with love and compassion. And not that I am always in that by any means. And that's my, you know, ongoing life's journey. But, you know, war is not the answer.
Right. Right. Actually, the love piece of this, I just co-wrote a chapter with Alan Shore on love as kind of the leavening force of play and creativity. And that's the last book that I did is called Play and Creativity in Psychotherapy, also with Norton. It's an edited book. And we've been talking about love more. And I think that therapists need to be talking about love more and recognizing that it, how potent an ingredient it is within therapy, even not just, you know, to cultivate in marriage and between spouses or people dating, but that really it I think is kind of one of the hidden healing elements, maybe the most important at some level, is the love that we feel for the people that we're working with and how much that's at the basis of compassion.
That's beautiful. I agree. And it's interesting because sort of as a parallel to what we were saying in the beginning of our conversation, that like intuition has been somewhat of an off limits topic in therapy for so long, love is too.
Yeah. Yeah. Love was associated with erotic transference and such a no-no that, and then all of the stuff about you can't touch, you know, you can't give a hug and all this stuff. Absolutely. It takes courage, I think, to go against, and that's part of intuition, isn't it? Is having the courage to go by those inner senses of what's right and what needs to happen, as opposed to practicing defensively and fearfully according to third-party payer mandates or
fear of being sued.
Fear of being sued. Absolutely. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, if you're not, I mean, we should all practice in an ethical manner, of course, and do no harm. But if you're more focused on covering yourself from potentially being sued, how can you be doing, like, how open-heartedly are you practicing? If you feel like every client is a threat to you in some way,
that's right.
Sounds awful.
That's going to block intuition right there. That's, you know, it's
yeah,
a different principle. Operating. I mean, there's a trauma principle operating.
Exactly. Terry, this has been so fascinating, and I am grateful for you giving your time to me and our audience. I think I could pick your brain for probably months.
Oh, you're welcome to pick my brain for months if you'd like to, anytime.
Oh, I'd love to talk with you again, honestly. But I know that you have some events coming up where people can be with you in person. Can you talk about what you're doing and where people can find you?
Sure. I have a couple of different events. The one that I really want people to know about, I'm so excited about. I what I didn't mention about myself is that I've been a yogini for more than 40 years, and I've been called a pretzel in a former life. I think it's probably true. But I've been invited to go to Kripalu, which is in Stockbridge, Massachusetts, and it's kind of like one of the yoga meccas of the world, really. Mm. It's kind of like Esalen of the yoga world on the East Coast, and I am doing a 3-day workshop on clinical intuition, which should be really fun. So people don't need to be to practice yoga even, because we're not going to do that. But in between sessions, they can do that and do all the other R&R stuff that's available at the center. That will be on March 8th through the 10th. And another thing, we were talking about the interpersonal neurobiology, and I just agreed to do a workshop on understanding interpersonal neurobiology with the Insight Center in Los Angeles, and that will be in April.
Oh, wonderful.
Yeah, and that one will be a 6-hour straight one-day workshop, Saturday workshop. Another event I am was invited to Yale's Divinity School, and I'm going to do a panel on, this is going to sound crazy, but fractal epistemology for transpersonal psychology. It's kind of those woo-woo edges of intuition. And but people can find these things on my website, which is Marks-Tarlow, my last name, MarksTarlow.com. Under events, it has these various things. And I would really love, especially people on the East Coast, because I'm in Los Angeles. I'd love to see people in Massachusetts or out here if they're interested in going further into some of these topics. And thank you so much for having me.
Oh, you're so welcome. So let me ask, the event at Kripalu, is it for therapists only or is it for anyone?
There is for therapists.
Okay.
And there is CEU credit available. And actually, so is the workshop for therapists. I sometimes give talks and do podcasts and things like that. But most of the time, I work directly with therapists.
Wonderful. Well, I hope that it doesn't fill up before people get a chance to register for the one at Kripalu, because I know that a lot of people here on the East Coast are going to be really interested in that.
Oh, wonderful. That would be lovely. I think we'll have a great time.
Yeah. So I'll be sure to include your website, a link to your website in our notes for this episode that will be on everyone's phones when they listen. And Terry, thanks again so much for being my guest today.
Absolutely. Thank you, Laura, so much for inviting me. And anytime, I would love to come back.
Thanks so much for listening to my interview with Terry Marks-Tarlow. See why I said that this was such an interesting interview? She is a very interesting, multifaceted person. And I was really grateful that she agreed to come on the show. I'd love to know what you thought about this episode. Please get in touch with me by using SpeakPipe, or you can just send me an email. You'll find SpeakPipe on my website, therapychatpodcast.com. And you can email me at therapychat.podcast@gmail.com. I appreciate your support. Take care. Today's episode is sponsored by Therapy Notes. Being a therapist in private practice, there is a lot to keep track of. I know for me, as an owner of a group practice now with 5 clinicians, including myself, I would not be able to manage my practice without my EHR system, and I use Therapy Notes. And we use Therapy Notes for scheduling, billing, and managing all the clinical documentation. If you're a therapist who's thinking about getting an EHR for your practice, I highly recommend Therapy Notes. Get 2 free months by going to therapynotes.com and using keyword therapy chat. That's therapynotes.com and use the promo code therapychat. Just another reminder that if you'd like to become a member of Therapy Chat, supporting the podcast while receiving fun member perks and being able to communicate with me one-on-one, go to patreon.com/therapychat. If every subscriber donated just $1 per month, Therapy Chat would be able to keep going strong indefinitely. Thanks so much for your support.
Thank you for listening to Therapy Chat with your host, Laura Reagan, LCSWC. For more information, please visit therapychatpodcast.com.